Two men mix sand and shovelfuls of cement, spending hours on end building their seawall, though rebuilding it, and higher each time. Banger Rorikki is working with his nephew Robin, who's been living in this house on Majuro, one of the Marshall Islands, for 22 years.
The high tide come very high.
He says the wall is meant to stop massive high tides, known here as king tides, like the one that surged through his home last year. On another of the Marshall Islands, Ibai, those same tides eat away the shoreline everywhere you look, tombstones shoved free and even swept out to sea. What used to be a park surrounding Ibai's power plant, gone. 74-year-old Belmer Marak has already seen king tides destroy several homes here.
I said the corner of the house was right over there, right outside that piece of concrete there.
These big slabs were part of the foundation of the house?
Yeah.
The Marshall Islands, a nation of slender atolls and five more substantial islands, sit in the South Pacific Ocean between Hawaii and Australia, no more than 6 or 7 feet above sea level. Climate scientists warn that if the current pace of global warming and sea level rise continues, then low-lying islands like the Marshalls could become incapable of sustaining their population within a generation or two.
Sea level is rising in certain parts of the Pacific faster than anywhere else in the world.
Chip Fletcher studies climate science at the University of Hawaii. He says that well before the Marshall Islands might disappear, they could face a more immediate impact from climate change, freshwater shortages.
What's the biggest threat now to the Marshall Islands?
Depends on your time scale. I think the longer time scale, sea level rise is probably the biggest threat, simply because it has the potential to rise above the average elevation of the Marshall Islands. Shorter time scale, though, it's the fundamental need for fresh water.
On Ibai, fresh water is Belma Marak's biggest worry. In his home, the spigots hooked up to the town water system are dry.
No water.
His son lugs buckets of water so the family can shower and flush their toilets. The family relies on rainwater catchment tanks for water, but those remain practically empty because of a relentless drought.
We barely have any water, probably this much. Barely have enough.
Getting fresh water has always been a preoccupation for the Marshall Islands. Most communities rely on rainwater collection, rooftop gutters connected to water tanks outside of virtually every home, and a few underground freshwater aquifers they can access through wells. The fresh water is essential for cleaning, personal hygiene, doing laundry, and of course for drinking. But as life in the islands became more westernized and the population grew to more than 50,000 people, those limited freshwater sources became more stressed than ever. And now, because of climate change, the traditional water sources are at increased risk. The droughts are getting so long that collecting enough rainwater is becoming harder and harder. The freshwater wells and underground aquifers are at risk of being fouled by saltwater from frequent flooding. Some wells already spoil because of high tides driven by rising sea level. Those so-called king tides now sweep over the Marshalls more intensely and more frequently.
It's an irony not lost on some climate change experts that while the Marshall Islands are among the sovereign nations that contribute the least to global warming, they're also among the nations that face threats that are the most profound and immediate.
Hilda Heine, the president of the Republic of Marshall Islands, is keenly aware of the paradox of living here. It's the old cliche, water, water everywhere, and not a drop to drink.
Been fighting this climate change for the last maybe 5 to 10 years.
Yeah.
Our islands are still livable. So we continue to have hopes. And so I think we're able to make sure that people are safe. And during droughts, we're able to provide water, food, and so on. So that's what we need to do. It's the new norm. But that doesn't mean giving up.
President Heine says the government has made freshwater access a priority and points to improvements in the centralized water systems on the two most crowded islands, Majuro and Ibai. But those systems supply only a fraction of the population and for limited hours each week. On Majuro, home to 27,000 residents, severe weather events put enormous pressure on the main water source, 7 reservoirs that store rainwater collected from the airport's runway. Halston de Broom is operations manager for Majuro's government-run water company. He says the drought last year nearly depleted their supply.
This reservoir was half. That one is empty. reservoir number one and two were pretty empty as well. The only water that we did have was pretty much in the covered reservoir, the treated water.
DeBroom says so that a more severe weather event could really leave them scrambling.
So if the big one hits next month, you guys aren't ready for it, at least not.
No. If a big one hits next month, we won't be ready for it, and then we'll have to find other ways to provide water.
But DeBroom says he is confident that coming improvements will one day provide all residents 24/7 water access, even during droughts.
I think if we improve what we have here, what we have, the infrastructure work that we have now, improve the pipeline, improve our catchment area on the runway, and then build more reservoirs, bigger reservoirs, so that we could store it more.
On Ebi, the main freshwater source is a 14-year-old desalination plant that's undergoing a nearly $5 million upgrade. But right now, it's less than a panacea for the more than 10,000 people living in this densely populated setting. For one thing, the water is piped into households only 45 minutes a day and 2 days a week, and it isn't safe to drink without boiling it. For most of their water needs, residents come to this public tap. But even though this water is tested on a regular basis, many residents are skeptical.
Do you use it to drink or just cook with, or what do you do with it?
Well, I do both cook and eat and also a bath shower.
But do you drink it straight?
Not really. I don't drink the water here. I drink the water on quads.
Quaj is the U.S. military base on neighboring Kwajalein Island. Ferries throughout the day from Quaj bring jugs of good, free, and safe water from the base's own state-of-the-art desalination plant. These 5-gallon jugs from the ferry weigh more than 40 pounds apiece, and they are a load to carry. Health risks from contaminated water are a constant worry on the Marshall Islands. Waterborne illnesses are one of the top three conditions treated at Ebi's hospital. When we journeyed to one of the most remote Marshall Islands, Arno, home to just 1,500 people, we saw a health worker educating children and adults about the risks of contaminated water and how to clean and test water to make sure it's safe. Still, after the lecture, we met Tarjadik Arwan, who was drawing fresh water from one of the few wells still producing. She says children in the village have contracted pink eye, diarrhea, and typhoid fever from the wells. A few miles away, a man named Konio Joe relies on this tank to provide water for his family's home, which he built after a king tide last year swept away his old house a few yards closer to the shore. Climate scientist Chip Fletcher says there are ways to at least delay the impact of sea level rise and saltwater intrusion.
What's the rule of thumb? If you wage war with water, you will lose. Yield and elevate. Yield to the water and elevate.
By that, Fletcher means accepting the consequences of seawater rise and moving homes inland into higher ground. That's why Fletcher and his team are creating three-dimensional models of the Marshalls, like this one of Hawaii's Oahu Island, to show where flooding is most likely to occur as sea level rises and what could be done to defend against it, like building more robust seawalls around the perimeter of the islands. Fletcher says that's an approach that should be considered by the Marshall Islands or by other low-lying Pacific Ocean countries like Tuvalu, the Cook Islands, and the Carteret Islands of Papua New Guinea, all of which are seeing an exodus driven partly by climate change.
There are communities that are sort of poised on the edge of the cliff, I believe. All it takes is, you know, one event, a king tide event, and that might be the killer event to push you over the edge.
How close are you, do you think, to the kind of destructive weather event which will signal a profound change in the way you should or the world should look at climate change?
Well, we're practical, and I think we're looking at the mitigation efforts, adaptation, how we can make the country resilient, people resilient to effects of climate change, and we continue to do that. We cannot think about evacuating our countries, our island, because people are connected to their land. If we're not on these islands, then we're not a people, we're not a country.
The president does fret about the seawall she showed us that stands between her own home and the water that rises higher each year, a barrier that she says erodes with every king tide. In the meantime, the president's across-the-street neighbor on Majuro, Banga Roriki, keeps building and rebuilding his seawall, hoping his home can survive.